There we go. Welcome to worship at Memorial United. I'm Pastor Chris, along with Pastor Shannon, beginning tomorrow. We're excited that he'll be joining us. The next Sunday will be his first time with us. If you would, please, let's stand and sing.
Some people think you're destined just some words on a page, that you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. But I've seen you part the waters when no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me.
Some people think you just live in cathedrals made of stone, but I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset and in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are.
Sometimes I have my doubts, I'm sure that everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love?
But I know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you down on my knees. You're everything I need.
You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are to me. You're forever holy. You're the Lamb who is worthy.
My forgiveness.
Open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are. You are greater, higher, over it all. In your presence, Jesus, I stand in awe of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me.
That's who you are.
That's who you are to me.
That's who you are.
Who you are to me.
That's who you are.
Who you are to me.
That's who you are.
Who you are to me.
Let's open in a word of prayer. O God, you have taught us to keep all your commandments by loving you and our neighbor. Grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit that we may be devoted to you with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Soften my heart,
just what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I need you to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. And all I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. 'Cause I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. 'Cause I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. 'Cause I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my
raised as my conscience found a silly little lie. It didn't mean much, but it lingers still in the corners of my mind. Still you call me to walk on the edge of this world, to spread my dreams and fly. Future so far, my heart is so frail. I think I'd rather stay inside, but you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life that I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Oh, it took more than my strength to simply be still, to seek but never find. All the reasons we change, the reasons I doubt, and why do loved ones have to die? But you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Oh Lord, how you love me. I am a the sweat from your brow, but you love me anyway. I am the nail in your wrist, but you love me anyway. Oh, I am Judas's kiss, but you nothing in life that I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Yeah. Oh Lord, how you love me. Yes, you love me. Yes, you love me. Yes, you love me.
Be seated. So at the last service, the Duncans did Down to the River to Pray a cappella, and I thought, dang, folks got music here. You all got pipes. Holy cow, 10:30 is on the clock. Let's see what they got. It is wonderful to be with you, friends. My name is Mark. I work at the conference office. I spend my time with churches doing congregational excellence, so I'm in a different church every week. So I hear a lot of music. Y'all like an embarrassment of riches musically here. Gosh, so much fun to be in worship with you all today. The bishop sends his greetings. He's in prayer for us as we worship. And this is fun for me personally because 20 years ago, right after being graduating from seminary, my very first appointment was to Leadwood and Irondale. So for my newly married wife and I, when we wanted to shop or eat or watch a movie, we drove into town, into Farmington. My wife is an immigrant. When she got her green card, her very first job was down the street at the Steak and Shake. So it's kind of fun to be back. Not to you all, because you don't know me, but back to this area, because I have some fond memories of St. Francis County. So it's wonderful to be with you. When I was in college, I stumbled into a church one Sunday morning, and I heard a preacher ask the question, does your reputation equal your testimony? And I don't remember hardly anything else the preacher said for the rest of the 20 minutes, but I remember that question, and it's haunted me ever since. So I want to get on the same page with you in terms of definitions. You all know what reputation and testimony mean, but when I say reputation, I'm merely talking about what do people say about a person or a thing. What do people say about a person or a thing? The testimony is, what does that person or what does that thing say about itself? And the question is, are those two things the same thing? So if I said to you, after the 10:30 service, I got to eat somewhere, where should I eat? What I get back from you is reputation, right? When I go to that restaurant, what they say about themselves is testimony. And the question is what they say about themselves and what you say about their food the same thing? And of course, it's the exact same thing with our faith, our walk, and our Christianity. So, I told you that I got that question when I was in a church service in college, just before I got to college, 3 weeks before I became a freshman at Mizzou. I was going to be an education major. I wanted to teach high school history. I wanted to be a track coach and a cross-country coach, and I still think that would have been amazing. But just before I went, my friends talked me into going to a spiritual retreat that at the time was called Chrysalis. And at Chrysalis, God called me into ministry, and it was the most unsettling thing that has ever happened to me in my life before, because I already knew what I wanted to do. And then God had this other plan. And I didn't have a full toolbox of coping mechanisms for a change in the plan at that point. So I did what any 18-year-old would do. I made a deal with God. Or you might even call it a bet. I mean, not only was I 3 weeks away from enrolling in class, but I also had signed up to be a part of my brother's fraternity. And I was going to Mizzou to have some fun. And I didn't want God to get away in my fun. So I told God, here's the deal, or the bet, if you like. If after 4 years of me being a heathen, you still want me to go to seminary, I will go. And based on me standing here, I lost the bet, right? But here's the funny thing. The funny thing was, while I was in college, starting the end of my sophomore year, then my junior year and my senior year, people would say, what are you going to do after you graduate? And I would say, well, I think I'm going to go to seminary. And then they would reply with, you? Because the way I was living was not the kind of lifestyle that you think a person standing up on Sunday morning would live. My reputation did not equal my testimony. Now, when that happens, you've got two choices. Change your reputation or stop talking. It was sad, but I decided just to stop talking about who God was for a couple years. Because I was stubborn and I wanted to live the way I wanted to live. Now, God wins, right? But it's an interesting thought process, because that question has still haunted me 25 years later. Does your reputation equal your testimony? And today what we're going to do is we're going to walk through my favorite scripture in the entire Bible. We're going to read way too much scripture, way too much, the entire book today, okay? It's only 25 verses, but it's way too much. If you want to follow along, it'll be on the screen. You can also pull up like an app on your phone if you want to follow along and read the verses there. It's right in between Titus and Hebrews if you've got a physical copy in your hands. But there's only three people in this book that you need to know about. The first is Paul. The leading apostle at the time, Paul, is writing a letter to a person named Philemon. Now, he wrote letters to all kinds of churches. He was the most letter-writing fella in the New Testament. Colossians and Philippi and Galatia and Corinth. These are all letters from Paul to churches in those places. But this is a letter to an actual person. Philemon is a small-time pastor in a house church. Scripture says, and the church that meets in your house, which pretty much means it's not a big building like this, but probably a living room with 15 to 20 people. And Philemon's probably a multi-career person, right? Works a job during the week and preaches a little bit on Sunday. So Paul is writing this letter to Philemon, and he's writing this letter to Philemon about the third character named Onesimus. Weird name, probably don't know anybody named that. Say that with me one time, Onesimus. There you go. So Onesimus owed Philemon money. You know, back then, if you owed somebody money, you would spend months, even years, working it off, right? But Onesimus doesn't pay the full debt. He skips town. He finds Paul. Paul writes him a get-out-of-jail-free letter that gets put in the Bible. And then Onesimus carries the letter back to Philemon. So buckle up, because this is a good old-fashioned triangulation that we find here in Scripture between these three people. And as we're reading through these verses, I want you to think about the question for each of these three characters. Does their reputation equal their testimony? First three verses. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, Apphia, our sister, Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church that meets in your house, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Philemon knew who Paul was. He was like the Billy Graham of the time. But there's no sense that we would have had that Paul, who has been traveling all over Asia Minor, would have had any idea about this little living room preacher named Philemon. So when Philemon gets this letter in the mail from Paul, it's the equivalent of the very first time I got a letter from the bishop. And I was so excited, and I screamed, and I ran, and I showed my wife, and she goes, this looks like a Christmas card that every pastor in the conference gets. But she couldn't steal my shine. I was excited. Didn't matter that signature was stamped on there. It was stamped on there with love, right? And so this is what Philemon could be thinking. Paul, the Paul, is writing to me. And look at this. He also says, hello from Timothy. And he's also addressed other people. Not just me, but Apphia and Archippus and the church that meets in the house. So if I'm Philemon and I got a letter from somebody like this, I'm not just reading the letter. I'm like, hey, y'all, come here real quick. Look at what we got in the mail. So everybody's starting to gather around. Verses 4 through 7. When I remember you in my prayers, Paul says, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith towards the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. If you're Philemon, you are losing your mind. He doesn't just know who I am. He thinks I'm doing good stuff. He used the pronoun we. He's imagining when he gets out of imprisonment for being too good at spreading the gospel and making the Romans upset. He's saying that we may do things for the gospel together. He thinks that we may team up. This is Billy Graham calling Chris and saying, Chris, let's go on the road together. And Chris would be like, hey, Memorial, I'll see you in a month. Right? This is big time. Now the rest of the letter, the tone doesn't look anywhere like that. But if you want to ask something difficult of somebody, you catch more flies with honey. And the first 7 verses are a lot of honey. To everybody that meets in your house, grace and peace to you from the Lord Jesus Christ. I can't imagine all the amazing things I keep hearing about what are happening in your living room with those 15 people. I can't even imagine all the cool stuff that we're going to do for the kingdom someday when I get out of jail. So excited to be writing you this letter. And so if you're Philemon, if somebody's breathing and they're in the area and they're not in your room listening to the contents of this letter, you've screamed at them by now. And that's what makes the rest of the next 15 to 20 verses so hard to hear. For this reason, Paul says, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love, and I, Paul, do this as an old man, now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I'm appealing to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Okay, Onesimus used to live with us. He still owes me money. He has not paid his debt. He ran away. Don't know where he's at. And now the leading apostle of the time is writing to me on Onesimus' behalf. He says, I could command you to do your duty. Like he's flexing an apostolic muscle. I could command you, but I'm appealing on the basis of love. Do you know what this sounds like? This sounds like my mom saying, Mark, I'm going to go to the grocery store. And when I come back, I'm going to take a look at your room. Now, I'm not telling you to clean the room. I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. We all know what that means, don't we? Get in there and clean the room. But he doesn't want to command. He wants to appeal. For that guy, it's like the equivalent of going to lunch and the dude skipped before the check came. Then you see him at Walmart later that afternoon. Are we buddy, buddy? Or am I like, hey, dude, you owe me $20. Except back then it was like years, right? This is going to use the word slave, but think about Moses, 7 years to work to get somebody to marry him, right? We're paying off debts here, and it takes a long time, but this dude skipped town, and the bill is due. And you're writing to me out of the middle of nowhere, have never said hello before, not a text message, no shout out on social media, and the first thing I get is you writing about this clown? Verse 11. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be some service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. Now, if I wasn't mad before, I'm seething if I'm Philemon. I've already dismissed Archippus and Apphia and everybody else who's around. I've said, this is just a bunch of Greek. It's mumbo jumbo. Don't worry about it. Go back to what you were doing. And I'm thinking to myself, what in the Sam Hill is going on here? You have got to be kidding me. Formerly, he was useless to you. You're doggone right. He doesn't pay his part. In fact, there's a subscript in my scripture here that says the name Onesimus means useful. You know how every one of our names has a meaning? Like mine is strong warrior, which is the worst thing that it could possibly... I've never been in a fight in my life. More like weak warrior who loses all the time in video games. But his name literally means useful. Formerly he was useless to you. You're doggone right, and nothing's changed. How could something have changed? He hasn't paid anything. I am sending him, that is my own heart. You're telling me to treat him the way I would treat you? I'd roll the red carpet out for you. You've got churches started all over Asia Minor. You've got people believing in Christ. You help us understand what a second chance in life looks like. But this guy? And then you claim God's providence. Perhaps this is why he was separated from... He's not separated. The dude ran away. He skipped town. So that I might welcome him back as a brother? I've already got weird family. I don't need to add to it. Welcome him as you would welcome me. Yikes. I mean, this is... Do you get how unnerving this is? And it started out with those first seven verses. You're the best. I love you so much. We're going to do great stuff together. You're the best preacher ever. Woo! So do this because you want to, not because you have to, although I could command you to, and he's taking your spot, and you owe me. Verse 17, it just gets worse. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ, confident of your obedience. I'm writing to you knowing that you'll do even more than I say. I mean, good Lord. Good Lord. If you consider me your partner, how are we doing? How are we doing kingdom work in first century Israeli culture without Paul as a centerpiece of what's happening? If I'm going to do anything, I've got to have Paul as a partner. I will repay it? How am I supposed to ask Paul for money? He's in jail. Paul, Onesimus owes me $1,750. How's that going to happen? Am I getting repaid, friends? No. But it's the offer. It's the illusion, right? The illusion of choice. And then he says, I say nothing about you owing me even your own self. Scholars believe that Philemon came to faith through a revival that Paul had in his area before. And so you have this experience, you come to Christ through somebody's preaching. They're always a hero of the faith to you, and then later on they ask you to do this thing, then you're like, oh my gosh, I'd rather just go back to tent making before doing this. Confident of your obedience, I am sure you will do even more than I say. What's more? Huh? What's more than forgiving somebody the debt? Should I pay him money? Should I thank him for the ability to forgive his... What's more than forgiven? Verse 22. One thing more, prepare a guest room for me. I'm hoping through your prayers to be restored to you. That's like mom saying, and when I come home, I'm going to take a look at the room. By the way, I told everybody in the world about this. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you. So do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of the Lord Christ be with your spirit. He tagged the world, put it on social media, put a blimp up in the air with a little trailer, forgive Onesimus, and sent it out all over the world. But he doesn't want to force your hand. It's your choice. This is a classic case of first century manipulation. Isn't it? Isn't that what it feels like? Isn't this a weird book? Why the heck is it in there? And when I think about that, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, think how reputation and testimony are just woven through that in crazy ways. In fact, I'm going to put a little grid up here, I think. Just think about this from a reputation testimony standpoint. Talk about Onesimus for a second. His reputation is that he's a runaway. You can't count on him. He doesn't pay his debts. And so what kind of testimony are you going to listen to from a guy like that? Nothing. This is who I was in college. I wanted to have fun. I wanted to do what I wanted to do. I didn't want to follow what God wanted me to follow, so I didn't talk about God. After a while, it's a lonely place to be. Some people get to this point without even making bad decisions on their own. It's just things in life that happen to them. Think about people here in not in this room right now, but in the greater Farmington community. Can you think of people that don't have a good reputation? That's not fun, is it? Nothing to say, because people won't listen to a person like that anyway. Even language, person like that, right? What about Paul? Now, Paul's the leading apostle, but what was Paul before being a leading apostle? He was the leading persecutor. Before he was Paul, he was the artist formerly known as Saul, right? And before he got blinded in Acts 9 on the road to Damascus, he made a living out of making your life miserable. He was great at it. He was the best persecutor of the early church in the history of the early church. And that's the guy God chooses to save the church. Isn't it a weird God we love and serve and worship? Paul is proof that a second chance can change the world. Paul is proof that you cannot outsin God's grace. Paul is proof that God is never done with you, even when you are done with yourself. Even when you look to the future and you think, God could never use a person like me, I have discounted myself. I have disqualified myself from being able to do something to further the kingdom. God laughs at that and says, don't you remember Paul? Because Paul's entire testimony is that you can change too. And then you've got Philemon. He's giving testimony every single Sunday about who God is, right? He's a follower of Christ. He's leading a church. And he's got this reputation as this house church leader that he needs to live with. One of the hardest things about being a pastor and preaching on Sundays is we don't get to be bad. Not at preaching. Tons of us, I'm horrible. You don't have to, don't worry, I won't be back next week. My point is like, do you realize if I go and do something boneheaded tomorrow and I live in this town, I'm out of a job? You can be a bonehead and sell insurance, right? You can be a jerk and be a line cook at a restaurant. But if you're a pastor and you're a jerk Monday through Saturday, Sunday ends pretty fast. And Philemon is stuck because he's got this letter staring at him in the face about forgiveness that will completely upset. Think if everybody that owed you money just got forgiven because, what happens to the economic budget that you've set for your family? How does that work? It's very confusing. And so this letter, you can see this from all three perspectives, how this is a very interesting deal. There are times where you and I are in Onesimus's chapter in life, and if somebody doesn't give us a second chance that we don't deserve, nothing's going to change. There are times where we're in Paul's chapter, and we have built a reputation that is meaningful and life-giving to people based on second chances. What do we do with that reputation? And then there's Philemon, where what we say on Sunday sometimes comes into conflict with what we think, do, or act on Monday through Saturday, and what do we do with that? And so for each of these three characters, in addition to reputation and testimony, there's a third column I want to show you, a kingdom need. So look what the kingdom need is for these folks. For Onesimus, nothing will change unless he's given grace. Unmerited, undeserved grace. And until he gets that grace, he will be stuck from other people in the hole that has been dug for him or that he has dug for himself. He needs a second chance. Do you know what my second chance was called? Social media wasn't around when I was in college. That was my second chance. There's no digital footprint of all the nonsense. And God has changed me into a different person. And through God's grace, I can actually be employed as a pastor. Which if you ask any of my friends from college, that does not compute. You probably have a version of that story yourself. When you think of past chapters of your life and where you're at today, you can look back and see the hand and the activity of God in your life. Nobody is past saving. Even Darth Vader by episode 6 threw the Emperor over the edge. Right? We're all made in the image of God. There's always hope. But somebody's got to offer that grace. And God uses people like you and me to offer other folks that grace. And he does that sometimes through being in a position like Paul, where we have built up over a long time a reputation that other people can trust. And what God wants to know is, will you use that reputation to show some undeserved grace to somebody else? You'll be vouching for somebody that you don't know what'll happen. You'll have to put your reputation on the line. Are you willing to do that? Paul is in house arrest. He writes the letter. He doesn't have any idea where Onesimus is going to go with the letter. But do you know what happened? It's in the Bible. We've got it, so we know the letter made it to its target. Onesimus walked back to Philemon's house and knocked on the door and showed him the letter. You imagine the gall that took? And when Philemon is standing there and gets the letter, he's being asked to forgive debt. Isn't that one of the bases of every sermon you've ever heard? Forgiveness? You preach about it all the time, Philemon. Paul is asking if you're willing to show what it looks like with me. And so with all these kingdom needs comes a kingdom question that you and I can live into no matter which of these people we feel like we're walking in their shoes today. In terms of Onesimus, if you were given a second chance or a fifth chance or a 1,742nd chance, what would you do with it? If you are in a position now where you need some unmerited, undeserved grace and somebody gave that to you, how would you prove to them that that was a great decision they made? We are all where we are because of human investment in us from others. We stand on the shoulders of giants in the faith that have made us who we are. What do we do with that investment? If we're in Paul's position, whose benefit is your reputation for? Please don't live a life to get a plaque or a wing or a building named after you. Use your reputation to ruin it. One person at a time with people who everybody else has given up on. People who don't get a chance from anybody else. Stake your claim and your reputation. Be willing to have people think less of you because you're willing to help somebody else out that everybody else has given up on. If you're Philemon, where you're doing the best you can to be a Christian, this is where I find myself most of the time, asking myself, is what I believe on Sunday the way I act Monday through Saturday? If you're in that position, when you pray the Lord's Prayer, be very careful of the words "as we." They're dangerous and they're haunting. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive others who trespass against us. It's contingent. Do you know how I live? Gimme, 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 gimme forgiveness. I love forgiveness. My favorite thing is when my wife forgives me. She has to do it a lot. Why is it that it's so hard for me to translate that into offering forgiveness to other people? I want to receive, I don't want to give. Do you struggle with that? Do you think in your mind there are some people past forgiveness? Do you watch a debate on TV and think the whole world's going to hell in a handbasket and that God's no longer alive and things can't be fixed? Why? In what world were humans in charge in the first place? We are stewards of a God who loves us more than we can possibly imagine. You cannot outsin God's grace. God sees potential in every person God's ever made, and we're invited to as well. And the thing that holds us back, more often than not, is withholding forgiveness from somebody else. Reconciliation takes two, forgiveness takes one. I can forgive somebody even if they could care less, because what I'm doing is I'm canceling the debt that I think they owe me. It could be monetary, it could be mental, or it could be spiritual, or it could be emotional. Gosh, it could even be physical. Forgiving other people is up to us. So where does this leave us? Well, Paul is proof of what God can do with a second chance. Philemon is proof that God will put difficult situations in front of us that we need to rise up to. But what about Onesimus? There's only one other mention of an Onesimus in Scripture. Scholars are divided on if it's the same one from this book. The only other Onesimus mentioned in Scripture is in the book of Acts, and he's mentioned as Bishop Onesimus. I don't know if it's the same one or not. I do know what I think God's reputation is. I do know what I think of who God is and what God wants for this world, and so I choose to believe it's the same one. When I get to heaven, I'll figure it out. My question is this. Does your reputation equal your testimony? If not, are you willing to have God help you rehabilitate your reputation? Because we live in a divided world, and that divided world cannot not hear about the love of Christ in their lives. Silent testimonies from people who desperately want to believe God is not the way to grow the kingdom. And so my hope is that God would help each of us grow into who we need to be. And you guys are in a perfect moment in your church's life. Because tomorrow, I don't know, maybe next week, some point, Pastor Shannon's coming. And the way you talk about your church will tell Pastor Shannon a lot. What reputation do you have in the community? What aspirational reputation do you want to have? Who do you want to be for this community? And as you think about that, both from an individual perspective and also as a faith community perspective, my deep, sincere prayer for you is that each day you will work to match the testimony God calls you to give with the reputation other people are lifted up by when they experience you. Let's pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for your love for us that never ends, for your forgiveness that is without merit and keeps coming our way, for a grace that's undeserved. God, we give you thanks because you remind us over and over again that we cannot outsin your grace, that we're not past saving, that everything can change, and that the future has hope and potential when we think about all the good that we may do for this world, when we partner up with people like Paul and Philemon and Onesimus to bring your forgiveness into a hurting world. God, first start by reminding us that we are forgiven, that the best is yet to come for our future, and then help us to bond together as a faith community, to remind this city here of Farmington and the extended outlying area that their best future is ahead of them as well. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said,
as we prepare to take up our tithes and offerings, a reminder that there are three ways to give here at Memorial. You can give as the plate is passed. You can text 73256 with Memorial UMC and the amount, or you can go to our website and select the Give tab. Now, as a forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God.
Told me who I am. sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again. Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I am yours. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours.
Let's pray. God, we thank you for this offering, for the gifts that we have given. We pray that they would be used for your honor and your glory. We pray that we might be a people who represent you well, whose reputation matches our testimony, who are a people known as Christians, not just in name, but in deed. We pray for those who are hurting in this world, those who are in need of a pouring out of your Spirit. May we help them in their time of need, just as you and others have helped us. And so together we pray as you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Thank you.
couple of announcements as we send you out this week. As always, I encourage you to look at the back of the bulletin or in our weekly email for lots of things that we have coming up. But I want to highlight a couple. First is a big thank you. We were collecting toothbrushes and toothpaste for the MAC international students who were coming in, and we well exceeded our goal of 300 of each of those. So I thank you for your contributions to that. What we have in excess, we're going to donate other places like the Uplift Center where people could use toothbrushes and toothpaste. So don't worry, they'll be used well. And then also want to highlight some opportunities to serve coming up. Eagle Lake camp is in just 3 weeks. And so there are a few opportunities still that Cindy is looking for people to help out with. First, we're still collecting those packaged cookies if you want to drop those off at the church office. She also needs some volunteers to help with check-in and check-out at the tables. The times are listed there in your bulletin. And then finally, whether you know this or not, the church actually subsidizes camp for every single camper who comes. And we pay about $101 for each camper who comes through the doors so that it's more affordable for the parents to send their kids here to a week of camp and to learn about Jesus. So if you are able to contribute in any way, we would appreciate that. Any amount will help us towards that goal of bringing campers here.
Friends, will you stand? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen.